we should go see him, Beth. Dr. Berger.
What?
I thought we could all go and see him together.
Why?
He thinks it's a good idea.
Oh, he thinks it's a good idea? What does he know about me, about this family? I've never even met him.
Exactly, that's the point.
Wouldn't it be easier if we all talked about it in the open?
About what? What are we going to talk about? Don't try to change me, Calvin. I don't want any more changes in my life. For God's sake, hasn't enough happened? Let's just hold on to what we've got.
Darling, that is what this is for. Maybe you'll get a surprise.
I don't want any surprises.
That's a scene from Ordinary People with Mary Tyler Moore and Donald Sutherland arguing about whether they should see a psychiatrist to help them solve their family problems in Ordinary People. One of five new movies we'll be reviewing this week on Sneak Previews, a show where two film critics talk about and sometimes argue about the new movies in town. Across the aisle from me, Roger Ebert, film critic of the Chicago Sun-Times. Welcome back to the balcony, Roger.
Thank you, Gene. This is Gene Siskel, film critic of the Chicago Tribune. And here we go again with the first program of the new season for Sneak Previews. We took the summer off, but now we're back, and later in the show, Spot the Wonder Dog will also be back to help introduce our regular feature, The Dog of the Week, the week's worst movies. But first, in addition to Ordinary People, we'll also be reviewing the intense family drama, The Great Santini. We'll look at a modern love triangle in Willie and Phil, and we'll review one man's midlife crisis in Middle Age Crazy. And now Gene starts with the new Bette Midler musical, Divine Madness.
In the last decade, Bette Midler has become a major show business phenomenon. Since starting out as an entertainer in a gay bathhouse in New York City, she's conquered nightclubs, records, books, and movies last year with The Rose. Her new film is a documentary of a recent concert series she gave in California. It's a no-holds-and-no-language-barred performance. She sings, tells jokes, dresses up in clever costumes. Here she is in a lavish send-up of that golden oldie, Chapel of Love. That's an old vaudevillian routine, the two-sided costume, and that's typical of Bette Midler because she is really, I think, a traditional old vaudevillian. Even more than her voice, I think her fans really love Bette Midler for her earthy, raunchy sense of humor. In one of the movie's best monologues, Midler tells the audience all about her recent trip around the world.
Really, I was real surprised. I thought, you know, when you go around the world, you get yourself a little book of coupons, you know, and you go to the Swiss ride, and then you go to the French ride, and, you know. No, and it's nothing like that. All the countries are very far apart from each other, and they none of them speak each other's languages, and they all hate each other's guts. So I had to go all the way around the world to discover that they're really not my kind of people. First place we went to the UK, the United Kingdom, or as we like to call it, the yuck. We were real touristas over there. We did it all, you know. We walked the Bloody Tower. We read Milton until we went blind. God, you're fast. But we were really lucky, you know, because we got to actually lay our two eyes on her hiney, the queen. Have you ever seen her? Oh, kids, she is the whitest woman in the whole world. She makes us all look like the third world. There can be no question that she is a Protestant. Really, she has a wardrobe and everything. I only have one question to ask her, Madge. What have you got in that purse? What's she got in that purse? What do you think she's got in that purse? I mean, you know she hasn't got car fare or nothing like that. Probably has a little identification card that says, I am the queen. Oh, I tell you, I'd kill to get my hands on one of those hats. Who do you suppose makes them hats for her, huh? Probably has a little hat fairy down the basement stitching up them hats. saying to himself, oh, Queenie's gonna love this one. How old a woman would you say I was?
As with so many concert films, evaluating Divine Madness comes down to how do you feel about the performer, Bette Midler? If you're a fan, you'll almost certainly love Divine Madness. If you can't stand her, I don't think this is going to change your mind. But it may win over a lot of people who haven't seen her work before. Yes, it's raunchy at times, lots of rough language, rated R, but her commanding stage presence and her range of humor and music are impressive. Midler, to me, is in the tradition of the classic music hall performers who sang, danced, told jokes. She's a complete entertainer, putting on a very good show here.
And you know, she involves the audience in it too. One of the nice things about this film and the way that it has been filmed is you get those sidelong glances and the big smiles. She lets everybody in on the joke. And another thing, a lot of the concert films I've seen have basically been 2 hours of the same stuff. After a while, it gets to be really repetitive. Midler, I think you're right. She's like an old vaudeville performer, a veteran music hall performer. She sings serious songs, funny songs. She tells jokes. She's in skits. She plays characters. She dances. She does a stand-up comic monologue. She's all over the map. She's like a one-person variety show.
And it's the best one-person movie show, I think, or concert film we've seen since Richard Pryor's a year ago. It's terrific.
I think I'm in agreement with you. Our next movie is about a love triangle, and so you'd expect it to involve jealousy, heartbreak, deception, and despair. But that's absolutely not the case with Paul Mazursky's Willie and Phil, which is about a love triangle that sort of works. It's the story of three liberated young people, a woman and two men, who grow up together in the 70s and see no reason to let a romance spoil a beautiful friendship. Margot Kidder plays the woman, Ray Sharkey and Michael Ontkean are the two men in her life, and in this scene they invite her to move in with them.
My rent's due tomorrow, and there's no way, short of selling my body, that I can afford to pay for it, so I gotta find a place to live. Back to the boondocks.
Well, that's quite a predicament. Tu casa.
You can stay at my place.
You can stay at the lodge.
I got a spare room. There's a room right in the front that I just use for storage.
You know, are you kidding?
Any sexual strings attached to either of
them? Oh, no, I know you're joking.
No.
Come on.
Strings.
How can you think that? Look like a pervert.
I wasn't even asked for any rent. This is a free offer.
Hold that.
Uh-oh.
Sir, excuse me. Could you lend me a coin of some sort? Like a quarter or nickel? A penny would be fine.
There you go.
Oh, thank you very much.
Want a drink too?
No, thank you, sir. Not right now. Thank you. No strings, huh?
No. Go ahead.
Okay. Heads, it's Willie, and tails, it's Phil.
At about this point in the movie, if you're a movie buff, you may begin to suspect that the basic situation in Willie and Phil is taken directly from Francois Truffaut's 1961 French film, Jules and Jim. Well, that didn't bother me. I enjoyed Willie and Phil. I enjoyed its guided tour of the fads, the cults, the various alternative lifestyles of the last 15 years. While at the same time I was thinking that the movie is a little contrived. These people are not spontaneous. They almost seem to know that their lives are inspired by a screenplay. But Mazursky's nice sense of social satire, I think that makes up for that.
I think you put your finger on the weakness, and I disagree with you here. I don't like the movie a lot. The weakness is, as you mentioned, it's not spontaneous. There's a narration, as you know, that goes throughout the whole film. Mazursky, the director's voice, telling us what the character's feeling, and then we see them feel it. I think that was a big mistake. Takes away the spontaneity. It doesn't let the actors breathe. They seem a little cloistered as they talk, afraid of hearing that director's voice, maybe. I just thought that the film really didn't spend enough time aiming in on the nature of a three-way relationship, and instead, as you mentioned, drifts off into the 70s material, history of fads, didn't stick to the point, I thought.
I think you're almost asking this film to be something that was never intended to be. I don't think it's intended to be psychological realism. I don't think it is. I think these characters are setups in a way. And the movie's kind of like a series of satirical reviews or sketches in which Mazursky is going to places like Greenwich Village, India, Southern California, places where in the 70s things began and spread out to the rest of the country. And he's kind of making fun of that. Another thing that he does is allow all the parents into the movie. All of these three kids, their parents, have scenes in which they react to this material. I like that.
Well, I didn't like the parents. I thought they were three stereotypes, one Italian, one Jewish, and one Southern. As for it not being real or not wanting it to be real, but he's using the real time, Greenwich Village, real places, real dates, we have a big disagreement.
I think that's permitted.
Okay. Our next movie is about a subject that Hollywood has avoided for a long time, the American family. That's been changing lately, fortunately. First, there was Kramer versus Kramer, last year's Oscar-winning Best Picture. Later in the show, we're going to be talking about ordinary people. Now we have The Great Santini, an excellent portrait of a family that battles together and stays together. The center of the family is the father, played by Robert Duvall, a Marine colonel who rides roughshod over his children, particularly his oldest son. Here he takes on the boy in a vicious game of one-on-one basketball. The father has never lost one of these games, ever.
Hey!
99! Don't worry, Colonel, you can always get a disability pension.
Don't goad him, Ben. Don't goad him now. Come on, let's play.
Last shot of the game, Jocko. Give up? Uh-huh.
Stay close, Ben. Now watch him.
What is Fanny, Ben?
It is I, the great Ventini! You know, Dad, not one of us has ever beaten you in a single game. Not checkers, not dominoes, not softball, nothing.
Watch it, Ben. He's getting that look.
Come on over here. Come on over here to Daddy Bull.
Come
all
on.
Over. Get out of here before I knock every freckle off your face.
Ming. Wasn't that great?
Come on, Jocko. You got to win by two baskets. He said one. I changed my mind. Let's go.
Now, you're not going to cheat the boy out of his victory. Come on, be a good sport.
Who the hell asked you anything?
Don't you talk to me like that. No, you won't. Now, he beat you, and it was beautiful.
Lily, you better get in the house before I kick your butt.
It was just beautiful.
No, I mean it. Come on, let's go. Hurry, come on.
Touch that ball.
You better move, woman.
All right.
Come on, let's go. Come on.
He's beaten you.
That's pretty brutal, but there is a core of caring for his children that's deep inside Robert Duvall. He loves his kids, but his military role has taught him to keep his emotions bottled up. Now watch what happens in this scene when Duvall wakes up his son at 4 a.m. to give him a birthday present.
What is it? It's a training bra. Open it. I've been saving it for you for 18 years. Good. That was my first. I wore it in WW2 when I flew with the Cobras.
It's great, Dad. Thanks.
They don't make them like that anymore. It's part of the old core. You're 18, Ben. I woke up thinking about the day you were born. I was on a hop. And all I heard when I landed was that your mother was in a hospital. So I went crazy. I hit 100 miles an hour getting there with the MPs chasing me. Knocking nurses out of the way, running over the small children, crashing into patients on the way to the operating room. And you're screaming your head off. And I'm banging on the window trying to get your attention, bragging to everybody who'd listen that the toughest little fighter pilot in the world had been born. Then I ran down to see how your mother was, expecting her to look like some hell after punching you out of her system. Hell, she was sitting up, looking prettier than I'd ever seen her. That was 18 years ago. 18 years ago today. I was 23.
That's a beautiful monologue there. The Great Santini is not much more than a character study, but what a character. At first, like his children, we want to strangle Robert Duvall. Then we begin to appreciate the fact that he does care about his kids. He's caught in a tight place between his heart and his training. Needless to say, this is an excellent film for a family to see together and really discuss how they feel about this extremely strong father. I think you're going to have mixed feelings.
I'm in total agreement with you. I think this is a terrific picture for everybody to see. I think it's very interesting that only now is it going into release around the country. I think it's open in about 12 cities where it's doing very well. But this is a picture that after it first bombed in a couple of test markets in the South, the studio pulled off the market. They set on it. They were afraid to release it. They sold it to airplanes. They sold it to pay cable systems. They know how to sell exploitation pictures. They know how to sell multi-million dollar space epics. But get a nice little human drama that's about people, and they're baffled by it. Who would ever want to see this?
Well, you see, I think that's because the movie industry right now is playing up to kids, teenagers. Most movies are made for teenagers. Mm-hmm. Those are the ones that make the big hits, Grease, Star Wars, that kind of picture, Blue Lagoon. I think that the response to this film from the American public is really saying that the American public wants adult films, too. Mm-hmm. You know, adults want to go to the movies, too. And this film is really drawing families and adults in particular. We are starved for stories about older people. And I think that's what, we have very mixed feelings about the Robert Duvall character, but we hunger for this kind of character so much, we're drawn to this guy. Fascinating.
You know, they talk about family films that are for kids of all ages. This is a family film for adults of all ages, including mature kids.
Good phrase.
If you can follow that. As a matter of fact, I think The Great Santini is one of the best pictures of the year. And we're going to move on now to another movie that I think is also one of the year's best. So we're on a hot streak. This movie is Ordinary People, Robert Redford's first film as a director. Redford doesn't appear in this picture, but he does a more than capable job behind the camera. Ordinary People tells a story of love, pain, and self-deception in the upper-middle-class suburban family that it's about. Before the movie opens, one of the family's two sons has been killed in a boating accident. Now the survivors have to find a way to live together without him. Mary Tyler Moore plays the deeply troubled mother, and in this scene, she's angry because her one surviving son has quit the high school swimming team. He's done it months ago, and he hasn't even told her.
Really important to try to hurt me, isn't it?
Don't you have that backwards?
Oh? And how do I hurt you? By embarrassing you in front of a friend? Poor Beth, she has no idea what her son is up to. He lies and she believes every word of it.
I didn't lie.
You did. You lied every time you came into this house at 6:30. If it's starting all over again, the lying, the covering up, the disappearing for hours, I will not stand for it. I can't stand it. I really can't.
Well, don't then. Go to Europe.
Connie, now, Connie.
Well, the only reason she cares, the only reason is because someone else knew about it first.
Just stop it, Connie.
No, you tell her to stop it. You never tell her a goddamn thing.
Maybe this is how they sit around and talk at the hospital, but we're not at the hospital now.
You never came to the hospital.
Connie,
how do you know
about
the hospital?
Come to the hospital. Now, you know that she did. She had the flu, and she couldn't come inside, but she came
to
the hospital.
Yeah, well, she wouldn't have had any flu if Buck was in the hospital. She would have come if Buck was in the hospital.
Buck never would have been in the hospital.
That's enough. That is enough.
I won't do it again. I really won't do it.
What in hell has happened?
That was Timothy Hutton as the teenage son. He gives an extraordinary performance in Ordinary People because he doesn't simply get more and more disturbed and tortured the way you might think. He bottoms out, and then he learns once again how to grow and how to love. The changes in his personality are really what this movie is about. That and how his parents feel they ought to react to his emotional problems. His mother is especially uptight about involving a psychiatrist in private family matters.
I know I'm not perfect. And if I can't go around hugging everybody all the time the way you do, then I'm sorry.
I'm not asking you to be perfect. You're missing the point.
I don't want to see any doctors or counselors. I'm me. This is my family. And if we have problems, then we will solve those problems in the privacy of our own home, not by running to some kind of specialist every time something goes wrong.
Are you folks ready to order?
No, could you give me a couple of minutes, please?
Sure. Running to experts every time something goes wrong. I know you mean well. I want this to be a nice Christmas.
I do, too. I want all of them to be nice Christmases.
We need time together, Calvin, you and I. We have to get away. New Year's. We can spend some time in Houston with my brother and Audrey. You know, play a little golf. Relax. We need time together. Okay?
Okay.
I love you.
Donald Sutherland plays the father in Ordinary People, and he's very good as a sincere, well-meaning tax attorney who's always thought of his life as orderly, meaningful, and filled with love until his oldest son's death forces him to re-examine his whole world. The best thing about Ordinary People is that it's not just another one of those tragic suburban soap operas where everyone behaves self-destructively. It's a movie that deals intelligently and compassionately with how people can change and grow.
I thought it was a terrific film. You mentioned it's mostly about the kid. For me, I focused on the parents, and mm-hmm. I found the film presenting a very interesting idea, which is these parents are trying to deny that their life has problems. Mm-hmm. They're used to putting on a show in front of their friends and a show, I guess, in front of each other. And what the film is suggesting is an idea that I subscribe to, which is that life is about problems, mm-hmm. about mm-hmm. conquering them, dealing with them, and then creating new ones, because they're going to happen anyway. And that's what this kid experiences. The parents deny it, and then maybe tentatively get some idea about mm-hmm. changing it toward the end.
I think I'm picking up on something here we both agree in, and that's the underlying assumptions that this film has. The woman in this film, Mary Tyler Moore, she wants her house to look right out of the pages of Better Homes and Gardens. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, everything is in place in her house except for her husband and her son.
Yeah.
They're not in place, and she doesn't like that. But the son, who faces all of these problems, he feels guilt-ridden because his older brother has killed himself and so forth in the boating accident. He's got all of these problems, but he has the resources to look inside of himself, to not just give up. He seeks help. He looks for a psychiatrist. Mm-hmm. He talks to his father. He talks to friends at school. He tries to take control of his life and turn it around. I really like that attitude.
Another thing, this is, again, a film for families to see, mm-hmm. and another adult piece of entertainment, and I just can't underscore that point enough. I think that there's going to be a big response to this film, and I think, and I hope, that the Hollywood executives get the message that adults have $4 to spend on movies, too. Again, directed by Robert Redford, a terrific job his first mm-hmm. time out behind the camera.
Very good film.
Now we step down a little bit in class, a lot of bit in class. Middle-Aged Crazy, it's a film that starts out promisingly as a comedy, I think, then it makes a big mistake of trying to get serious. It doesn't work at all. It's the story of a man suddenly assaulted by a midlife crisis on his 40th birthday. Bruce Dern is the man, happily married to Anne Margaret. He's a successful businessman, but his 40th birthday really shakes him up, makes him want to reassert his youth, so he fantasizes about changing his clothes and trading in his car. That's sort of nice, but you got to wait until Bruce Dern opens his mouth. Then the film becomes very predictable. We're always way ahead of this story. We know that he and Anne Margaret are going to break up, and we suspect they're going to probably get back together again, and we're right. Anne Margaret and Bruce Dern are not a convincing couple. Both seem to be imitating Hollywood's cornball notion of what Texans are supposed to be like. When this film got serious, I just saw a couple of phony characters up there on the screen. They sort of blew this picture, a promising start.
I agree with you about the start. At the beginning of the film, I thought, hey, I like these characters, I like these situations, it's kind of funny, it's nice light entertainment. Mm-hmm. Then, about halfway through, they flip-flop when Bruce Dern has his big affair with the Texas cheerleader.
Yeah.
And he gets all serious, introspective. What does it all mean? What is my life all about? I liked it when it was middle-aged crazy. I lost interest when it became middle-aged poignant.
And that's the plaintive bark of Spot the Wonder Dog, meaning it's time for Dog of the Week, our regular feature where Roger and I each pick the week's worst movies. You go first this week.
Gee, thanks a lot, Gene. I'd like to kick off the new season with the Dog of the Week that really deserves a kick. It's a movie that's turning up around the country under the title of Satan's Plaything. The ads make it look like an action picture about three tough broads, but the entire campaign is a complete fraud. There is no new movie named Satan's Playthings, and none of these women are in it. This movie is actually a 10-year-old British thriller that was originally released under the title Assault. It stars Susie Kendall as a British schoolteacher, and it's about how her students are attacked and killed by a cult of devil worshippers. This is a great new trick, taking movies that were dogs in the first place under their original titles, then ripping us off again under new titles.
My dog this week is an old-fashioned Western called The Mountain Men. It's amazing these days to find a new movie that's so unashamedly racist about the American Indian. In this film, Brian Keith and Charlton Heston play a couple of fur trappers who fight the Indians in 1830 Colorado. An Indian squaw falls in love with Heston even after he smashes her in the face with his rifle butt. An old Indian wise man is portrayed as a lecher who lusts for young girls, and an Indian warrior takes down his pants in battle before he's shot in the butt. The Mountain Men is a boring, long-winded, racist film. Other than that, it's awful.
I think you don't like it, Gene.
Right.
Now let's take another look at the major movies on this program. Both Gene and I love the high energy and high spirits in Bette Midler's concert film, Divine Madness. We both recommend you see it. That's why there's a yes next to both of our names. We had a split decision, though, on Willie and Phil. I liked its guided tour of recent lifestyles, but Gene thought it was patronizing and much too cute. Two strong yes votes for The Great Santini, with its brilliant performance by Robert Duvall as a father whose emotions are trapped inside his military uniform. We strongly recommend this film. Another strong recommendation is for Robert Redford's Ordinary People, a compelling portrait of the tensions within a troubled suburban family. Finally, two no votes for Middle-Aged Crazy, which we both thought was okay as a comedy before it turned serious.
So sort of a special week in films this mm-hmm. week. Two excellent films about families. Two films that really, I think, may mark a return to more mature entertainment from Hollywood. And let's hope so, and I hope the public responds to it. I think this is a way of getting rid of some of these kiddie films.
And those two films are Ordinary People and The Great Santini. And you know, Gene, I know there are people who watch television and they may never go to the movies or only go to a few movies. And they might think all movies are violent or they're for kids or they're stupid. Part of the time, they're right.
Yes.
I think I could confidently recommend both of these films.
Two excellent pictures. That's it for this week. Next week on Sneak Previews, we'll review five more new movies, including The Second Coming of George Burns in Oh God, Book 2. Christopher Reeve, the man who played Superman, now in a wistful love story, Somewhere in Time. And Woody Allen's new film, Stardust Memories, The Pleasures and Pains of Being a Celebrity. Until then, we'll see you at the movies.
Funding for Sneak Previews was provided by this station and by other public television stations.